What is a food forest? Well, we're all quite familiar with forests and forests as an ecosystem with great diversity of plants, animals, and fungi all harmonizing together and interreacting in many, many niches and layers designed by nature, maintained as a system in perfect balance. Well, imagine that as a system that produces food, the majority of the elements in that system being productive. That's a food forest. So by understanding how nature designs forest systems so they're self-maintaining, self-replicating, we can model that system with productive species so that we can produce food in the most sustainable way with the minimum amount of input for the maximum amount of output anywhere in the world. That's a food forest system that we can actually design and work with in long-term and permanent situations. All forests have layers. So you start off with a canopy layer. That's the top of the forest. Then you have understory layers. And under those, you have bush and shrub layers, going down to herbaceous layers, which are non-woody plants. And then you have a root yield. You have plants that actually have large, starchy roots. And then on the ground, you have groundcovers. And you also have a vertical layer of climbers. Now, all forests have those layers. In the tropics, you can have emergent palms and understory palms, and you can have slight variations in different climates, but you have a basic set of layers that occupy all the space. When we design a food forest, we put that layering system into action to our benefit for production and maintenance through function. Here in the subtropics, you have tamarillo as an understory, and you have taro and coco yam and cassava as a root yield. That changes from climate to climate. Then you have understory productive trees like feijoa, guava, and citrus, and large herbs like bananas. And then you have support species like the ice cream bean and the tipuana tipu and casuarina. They're large trees, but they continue to support the forest by cycling nutrient. You also have understory nitrogen fixers, like the acacias and the leucaena and the cassia and albizzia species. They're all really good, fast-functioning, fast-carbon pathways that fix nitrogen and can be chopped to the ground for mulch as the space that they're occupying can be taken up by the productive species. Here we have rose apples, mulberry, we have large legume trees, and we have large fruit trees. So we have jackfruit, the largest fruit in the world. We have bunya pine, a very large nut, but we also have pecan, which is a nut tree here that's also deciduous, loses its leaves in winter. Then we have your classic mango as a large overstory tree. These are all space occupiers in a system that's incredibly stable when all the layers are complete and occupied. We can plant food forests by planting support species at the same time as the fruit trees and managing the support species to shelter and boost the productive species. Or we can just plant the pioneer support species until we get a stable canopy. But we don't want to go the other way round. We don't want to start with the productive species and work hard with lots of inputs to keep them in a healthy state. The support species do the work for us. It can be up to 95% of the mass in the early years are the legume trees and the mulch-producing trees that produce the biomass. We prune these, and these trees shed nitrogen to the soil because they have relationships. They're classic pioneers, and most are nitrogen fixing species. In other words, they have rhizobium bacterial partners in the soil that take nitrogen from the air in the soil and bring it into their plant bodies. And they then eventually die, and that nitrogen is added to the soil. Now, we can speed that process up. We can sacrifice those species with good timing after we've put them into relative placement. So over time, the species we sacrifice open up opportunities for our productive species. They shelter and support and provide the fertilizer, the soil conditioning, and the humus. So we stack the system in space, but we prune in relation to time. So we wait for the time of year when there is more rainfall than evaporation. After the period where it's been dry and the evaporation is higher than rainfall, there we need shade, and we leave the shade up. But as soon as the rainfall gets heavier and higher than the evaporation, we can start to cut and open up light avenues and space for our productive species to take up the gap. Now, over time, when we get to establishment, we've got less and less mass in pioneer support species and more mass in the productive species. And we end up with a reversal of mass. We have 95% productive and only 5% in support. So we don't just stack in space, we stack in time, and we speed up the process. These legume support trees that have been cut off as pollards may look a bit harsh, but they very quickly start to regrow. You can see here little shoots coming everywhere, and they're all the same. With the regrowth, we get a beautiful shade. Now, that's handy in the hot time of year when we've got a lot of evaporation over rainfall, and it's actually a nurse crop for your fruit trees when they're young. Later on, we may cut them more regularly and keep feeding the soil. And eventually we may cut them out at a lower cut. They'll shoot a few more times. We'll keep adding that mulch, and eventually we'll cut them at ground level and not allow them to grow leaves, so they actually die out. It's our choice. We're actually manipulating the forest so that it grows in our favor towards productive species. We change the way it grows in our favor. So here you see the pollard regrowth. And in just a few months in the subtropics, you can gain all this wood. Now, it might be once a year in a temperate climate, once every 6 months, every 3 months in the tropics. You're working with the cycles of the forest within climate. So you're feeding the soil with a fallen forest, and you're designing the way the forest falls. We can use animals to help us establish food forests. We can graze with larger animals, then they have to be out of the way because we're putting in the small plants. We can put in poultry, chickens and ducks, and they can prepare the ground. And then later on, when the trees are up, we can bring in maintenance cycles of chickens and ducks to speed the system up. And that way we can use our animals to gain an advantage while they're productive for us at the same time. I'm sitting in a food forest that's been recovered by ducks. This section here was well out of maintenance. I had quite a lot of long clumping grasses and unwanted plants we call weeds. We've put a fence around it, a temporary fence, electric fence, but we haven't even electrified it. We've put in 100 or so Muscovy ducks. In just over 3 weeks, they've totally changed the area. They've eaten most of the green material. They've flattened out the grasses, they've manured the ground, they've conditioned the soil, and it's ready for replanting with the support species and interplants and fruit trees where there's gaps. Taking this time advantage, this process of dynamic event, we can now jump in and put in a whole assembly of plants that'll bring it to a diverse interactive stability and possibly go right through to maintenance without ever needing this event to happen again. This is taking time advantage from an animal interaction to a replant, which we can do any time we slip up on our maintenance. Just 3 weeks ago, the ducks were here. Now it's recovered. We've planted in the support species and extra fruit trees. We've established extra groundcovers, and we've got a little footpath surrounded by wood prunings, branch prunings going right the way through on contour. It's on its way, and it's probably going into a permanent stable system from here on in. Food forests function as a living ecosystem, and they are so diverse and so stable. And there is nothing like this in modern agriculture. Nothing as diverse, nothing as stable, nothing as fertile. The production of soil is constant. The fertility is constantly increasing. The diversity of production is non-stop. So with a food forest system, you have a system that self-replicates over time. There are no systems that produce as much per square meter for the smallest amount of inputs. This is a system that is proven, even in urban agriculture. Many people have heard my quote, "You can solve all the world's problems in a garden." But what a lot of people don't know about that quote is, I'm referring to food forests. They will work anywhere. And these systems give us permanent security worldwide. We just need people to realize that if we all move in this same direction, we can solve all the world's problems in our food forest gardens and supply all our needs without causing any damage whatsoever. In fact, we, humanity, can be the most beneficial element on this planet.